Hallelujah. I greet you all in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It's a real joy to be among you. Pastor, thank you so much for hosting us, welcoming us. And I want to honor all the leaders of the different church groups that have worked together to make this possible. As Pastor said, we just were in Hong Kong a few days ago. We did a conference and then we're training some people, but we had to cut short our program and go back to Uganda to preside over the funeral of two of our missionaries who were working in Cameroon. They were killed in a train accident, and we had to go and preside over that and be together with the families. And we thank God for journey masses. We are back here. I'm going to ask my wife just to rise up and wave to you. Sheila. As a way of introduction, just want to say that we come from a ministry known as World Trumpet Mission. We feel our mandate is to go out into the world and blow the trumpet, preparing for the coming of the Lord among the nations, and to awaken the body of Christ and to say, let's put our act together and finish the work and be ready when he comes. Our ministry works in Africa, in Europe, in America, in Asia, and we have been to South America too. Most of our work, besides awakening, is also to equip, because we believe this is a work bigger than any one ministry, any one church, any one denomination can handle. So as many as can be equipped to go forth and reach out within their circles, we believe that's the will of God. Amen. And it's my prayer. I know that I've been here before, and we talked about prayer altars. I know prayer altars has been put as the heart of our being together this time. And I'm going to be touching prayer altars, but I want to touch something a little bit deeper than just prayer altars. Because prayer altars is a means to what God wants to accomplish. So I want to use this evening tonight, one, as a way of introducing ourselves to you, giving you more understanding of our background, where we are coming from, what we have touched, what we have seen, what we have heard, and what we have been able to carry that God has sent us out to go share with the nations, but also to lay a ground for us to be able to begin to dig deep into the whole issue of prayer altars. We have been in Asia, especially in Taiwan, where the Lord sent us in 2009, where we were crying to God, if these things work universally, take us to a nation where there has not been any recent move of God, and let us prove your principles. And he said, go to Taiwan. And we went to Taiwan, and God proved himself faithful. He did things that at first when we shared with the leaders, they said, impossible. No one can do that. People don't even have that time, and especially the leaders, we don't have that time. But eventually, God gave us the brokenness and the will to follow, and he proved himself faithful within the time he gave us. He proved himself faithful. It's my prayer that God will awaken his church in Singapore, not so much because it's a good and wonderful feeling, but because of his destiny, his purposes for the land of Singapore, for the people of Singapore and the region in the Southeast Asia. So I'm going to ask that we go together to the book of Joel. Joel chapter 3. And I'm going to read from verse 9 to verse 14. It says, proclaim this among the nations, prepare for war. Wake up the mighty men. Let all the men of the war draw near. Let them come up. Beat your plowshares into swords, and your pruning hooks into spears. And let the weakling say, I am strong. Assemble and come, all you nations, and gather together all around. Cause your mighty ones to go down there, O Lord. Let the nations be awakened and come up to the valley of Jehoshaphat. For there I will sit to judge all the surrounding nations. Put in the sickle, for the harvest is ripe. Come, go down, for the winepress is full. The vats overflow, for their wickedness is great. Multitudes and multitudes in the valley of decision, for the day of the Lord is near in the valley of decision. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, King of glory, we lift up your holy name. We proclaim that you are our God and there is none besides you. You made us and we are your people. And you apportioned us to the different nations of this world. Father, for your purposes to be accomplished in the fullness of your timing. Lord, I know it's not by mistake that you have gathered us this way, this evening. So I pray, Father, let your spirit brood over us. O God, minister to each one of us according to your purposes in our lives. Cause us to hear your voice. Cause us, O God, to respond to you, even according to the tasks that you have before us and the lives that you're calling us to. Lord, I pray that your word shall come alive in our hearts and shall bring a burning fire in our hearts. Oh God, I pray in the name of Jesus, let your kingdom come. Let your will be done. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. I am going to talk a lot about nations. The passage I've just read is a very, very short passage from verse 9 to verse 14, just about 5 verses. But God mentions the word nations just as many times as there are verses. In that passage, he's talking about nations, 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 nations. And I must confess, I grew up in a family which was devout, and by some chance, I grew up loving the Bible. And I read the Bible from cover to cover several times before I came to the place, to the point of giving my life to the Lord. But there are things that I thought I knew. But when the Lord began to speak deeply into them, I realized I had never even heard about them. And one of them is the issue of nations. Now, to give you a background and an understanding of what I'm talking about, let me just give you a little history of my nation, Uganda. And I do this not so much that you focus on Uganda, but that it may be a point of reference for you to begin to see concerning your own nation, concerning your own people, concerning your own responsibility in these last days. The passage we've just read comes from the book of Joel. The whole book of Joel is a wonderful, wonderful prophetic word. The first chapter is very interesting. It talks about the state of God's house in the last days, the way it will be, how the enemy will penetrate into the house of the Lord, and every wonderful thing that the Lord has planted in his people will be destroyed, will be eaten away. And God says in that time, he will say to his people, come to the altar and spend the night before the Lord and cry to the Lord and say, alas, for the day of the Lord is near. It's the state of the church as it will be in the last days. The state of his people as they will be in a semblance of being God's people, holy and acceptable, and yet with so much that was deposited, having been eroded and eaten away. And God does not bring judgment or speak condemnation. He says, come before me, come to the place of the altar and cry out. And when you go to chapter 2 of Joel, it starts by saying, blow the trumpet in Zion, sound the alarm in my holy mountain, let all the inhabitants of the land tremble. For the day of the Lord is nigh. And it says, it's a terrible day. It has never been before. and it is a day of gloom. But in that day, a great and mighty people will rise up. And there will be like no other people before, and there will be no other people like them after that. Now that's a very, very powerful statement. For God to say, there will be a time a people will rise up who have never been like that, and they will never be again. That's an assurance that these people that God is talking about, we do not have even a precedence to tell what they will be like, and there will be none after God has done that. But he says they will rise up when the day of the Lord is near, when the day of the Lord's return is near. And if you continue reading the entire second chapter, he describes this army and how they will be well organized. Everybody will know his position in the ranks of the Lord. They will not jostle each other. They will not cross their lines. And even when they fall on the sword, it will not harm them. And he says in verse 11, and God himself will utter a cry ahead of his army, and he will command his troops. So we are talking about something here that is gigantic. It's big. And God is saying, I'm going to raise up something that has never been before and will never be again. And I will come and be the commander before my people. And then I will move forward. And he says, because the day of the Lord is near. And again, he moves down to verse 15. And he says, now proclaim this, blow the trumpet, and call all the people to the house of the Lord. Even the scribes, the priests, the bridegroom, the bride, and the children, even the sucklings, bring everybody to the altar of the Lord. And let them cry to the Lord and say, spare your people, O God. Why should the nations say, where is your God? Beloved, we are living in a time when nations are beginning to challenge us and say, hey, where is your God? If you have been following the elections in America, you have seen a little bit of that. Where God is being ridiculed, believers are being ridiculed, and they're being taken for outdated. This is the age in which we are living. It's the age where the wise feel like it's obsolete to talk about God. I was in Canada, and we were speaking in a certain conference, and one of the leaders there was a professor in the university, and he told us how he went for a conference in France with other professors and learned people. And they would ask him about himself, and he would introduce himself and say he's a believer. And they came to him in private and said, do you really mean you read the Bible? And do you really mean you believe in that stuff? And they acted like, that's ridiculous. How can you be a scholar and at the same time believe that stuff? So this is the day in which we are. This is the day we are living in. And God says, in such times, the only counsel he gives his people, he says, come to the altar. Bring the priests. Bring the old people. Bring the children. Bring the bridegroom. Let even the bride come out of her chamber. Let even the babies and the sucklings come before the Lord. And all of you cry out to the Lord and say, God, spare your people, O Lord. This is the day we are entering in. And I want to say to you, it's not just a call for us to go to prayer. There is also an anointing that God is releasing in the nations. An anointing that is creating a yearning in people's hearts. A heart cry. People wanting to see yet a new move. A fresh move of the Holy Spirit. All over the world, wherever you go, there is a stirring. There's a rising and a desire to seek after God. There is more prayer going on today, possibly more than has ever happened in the history of the church. And this is not by accident. It's the working of the Lord. You remember when God came down in the book of Genesis chapter 18? He came to Abraham and he said, the sin of Sodom and Gomorrah has risen up to me, and I have come down to see if it is so. It's like when the sin, Bible says, when temptation grows, it bears sin. And when sin grows, it bears death. So when God sees the sin of any people reaching the place where it's about to give birth to death, God comes down. God comes down among his people. And what does he come down to do? Ezekiel 22 verse 30 says, "And I looked for a man among them who would stand before me and repair the hedge, stand before me on behalf of the land so that I do not destroy it." I believe this is what is happening today. The sin of the nations is reaching its climax. The blasphemy of the name of the Lord is reaching its climax. The promotion of evil instead of good, calling evil good and calling good evil, and calling right wrong and wrong right, it's reaching the climax. The impunity of mankind is reaching levels that God says in Isaiah 52, "For long have I kept quiet, but now I'll stretch my right arm and I will pour my vengeance upon the nations." And I believe that as he came down to visit Abraham and talk to him about Sodom and Gomorrah, wanting to see and stir the heart of Abraham into intercession, and Abraham responded and began to intercede and to cry to God, "What if there are so many righteous? Will you destroy?" And God says, "I will not destroy. Oh Lord, let me speak again." This is the kind of thing God is looking for. A people that will hear the burning of his heart, the cry of his heart that "I do not want to destroy." And they will rise up and stand in the gap on behalf of their lands, that God may listen to their prayer, and they will intercede and bring grace and mercy to come upon the nations. Otherwise, in this scripture we've just read, God is saying, gather the people, for I'm coming down to judge the nations. I'm coming down to judge the nations. And in Joel chapter 2, we see, he says, when the people do that, when the people cry out like that, God will hear. And he will be entreated on behalf of his people. And says, "And then I will remember, and I'll come down among my people. I will deal with the armies of the enemy that have devoured their land. And I'll push the armies of the enemy back from my people. And I'll push them out into the sea. I will restore what the enemy has eaten, what the cankerworm has eaten, what the locust has eaten, what the grasshopper has eaten. I will restore all that to my people. Then I will pour out the first rains. Then I will pour out the second rains. And I will restore the new wine unto them." Then he said, "And after all of that, then I will pour out of my spirit upon all flesh." Upon all flesh. It says men and women will see dreams, young girls and boys will see visions, and upon them he will pour the Spirit, and there will be signs and wonders not only on earth but also in the heavenlies. And saying, "And in that day there will be salvation in Zion, and whoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved, because there will be grace and mercy before the day of the Lord comes." These are things that God says. He will not do anything without telling his people. He will not do anything without telling his prophets. And he has put this in writing. It's before us. And we can see the signs all around us. We can see the deterioration of ethics and morals all across the world. We can see the way the name of the Lord is falling into disrepute all over, both in the house of the Lord as well as out there. But we know that God is not coming back for a defeated church. God is not coming back to mourn over the nations. He's coming back triumphant. He's coming for a victorious people. He's coming for a blessed church without spot and without wrinkle. A victorious church. So if before that can happen, there's going to be a real move of God all across the world. There's going to be a real shaking. There's going to be a real stirring. There's going to be a breaking down, a pulling up, uprooting everything that God has not planted. And there's going to be a breaking down of things God has not built. And there will be a new building and a new rising up. And the Bible says, in those days, the people who know their God shall be strong, and they shall work exploits. And these are the days that Jesus talked about and said, in those last days, you will be hated by all nations because of my name. Now, we love to think about our faith as being separate from the secular world around us.
We want to think that our faith is private. But Jesus told us in those days, your faith is not going to be private. Nations, governments, authorities are going to be concerned about your faith. You are going to be hated because of my name. You are going to be persecuted because of my name. Not only by brethren or people around you, but by nations, by governments, by authorities, by whole people groups. And it says in those days, sin will increase and the love of many will grow cold. And there will be so many deception and false Christs will rise up and false doctrines will rise up. But he said, he who endures up to the end, it is he that shall be saved. So we are living in a time of great confusion, a time of great calamity, a time where only those who know the truth will be able to stand and discern between which way to go. Because it's a time of deception. When they asked him about this time in Matthew chapter 24, tell us about the time of the end and the time of your return. The first thing he said, watch that nobody deceives you. That's the first thing he said. You want to know the signs? Watch that nobody deceives you. That means the last days are going to be times of deception. There are going to be times of delusion. There are going to be times when it is hard to discern between right and wrong, where to go and where not to go. And it's in those days that he says, only those who know their God shall be strong and shall work exploits. And he talks about all those signs that will come. But he shows that in spite of all those persecutions, the deceptions and the opposition, he says, and this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world to be a witness to every nation. Remember that? Every nation. And then the end shall come. Now, Jesus is pinning his work on what happens in the nations. He says, the end will not come. I will not come back until this gospel of the kingdom has been preached in the entire world, not just to be heard, but to be a witness, to make an impact, a visible witness, testimony in every nation. Then the end shall come. I was a minister, and I'd been leading for some time, and we were building a beautiful work in the rural areas and villages of Uganda. And the Lord led me to go back to Kampala and to start a work in the city center. Said, go raise me a 24-hour altar. I want a place where people are calling upon my name day and night. A place where my name shall be holy, my name shall be revered, where people will not come in and blaspheme my name, where people will come and know I am God and I am awesome, and they will come in my presence with reverence. So we came in the city with that, but when we started the work, we were a team that had worked together for many years, very close, sharing everything and sharing all our secrets. We had no secrets against each other. And yet, we got a misunderstanding that started small and began to grow and continued to grow. And any attempt to talk through things just made things worse. Then suddenly I realized we were getting cliques. People were just dividing themselves into cliques. And it was now them and us. And it was no longer just in the church. It was going into our families and was threatening to split marriages. I got alarmed. And I say to the Lord, I'm willing to do anything to stop this, but please help me. Show me what to do. I don't know what to do. And I felt the Lord lead me, go take a fast of 30 days. And I said, Lord, I will do it. So I came to the church, I told everybody, I'm going to go away for a fast of 30 days, and this is the focus. And when I started, the Lord amazed me, because from the very first day, he began to pour revelation before me. He began to show me things in visions and dreams and scriptures, and was showing me what the enemy was doing, how the enemy had penetrated into our midst, the deceptions, how we speak to one another and each one hears something different from what the other one has said, and how we are thinking things in our hearts, thinking he must be thinking this, that's why he said this. So there was no even hearing one another. And I marveled at how much deception can sweep a team that has been so tied together. But God was good. He gave me solutions. He showed me how to handle each person individually and how to handle the team together. And after about 2 weeks, I was so excited. I knew I had the solutions I needed. And I knew there's nothing more for me to pray for because I can see the solution to the whole thing. So I went before the Lord in prayer and I said, Lord, may I break my fast? Because now I have everything that I came before you to ask. And I don't have a time to go picking up the lessons and everything, but I just hope you pick this up. Many of us go to pray because we have things we want God to do for us. And God is willing to do those things, but he says, do you know I have things I want you to do for me? And prayer is not just a business of you coming to tell me what you need, because God knows what we need before we even ask. Prayer is more bringing us into fellowship that we may know what he wants, that we may know what burdens him, and how he wants to call us to be co-workers to carry it out. So in this moment, I said, Lord, may I? And the Lord said to me, if all you can see, if all you have got eyes for is the ministry in your hands and the calling on your life, then I want you to know you will never accomplish it. And that to me was so confusing. If I have focused on the calling you put on my life and the ministry you gave me to build, and I'm looking at nothing else, and then you tell me I will never accomplish it, then I don't understand. What's the logic? And the Lord said to me, you need to know what I'm doing through your life and through your ministry is a very tiny bit of what I'm doing in the world. And if you don't see the big picture, you will never see how your work fits into the big picture. And what you end up doing, you build where you are not supposed to build, and I break what you're building. You build in ways you're not supposed to build, and I oppose you. I uproot what you plant. You rise up and scheme for things that I've not planned for you, and I'm forced to oppose you. He says, I don't want you to labor in vain. I still remember those words. I broke in tears when I heard those words. He said, I don't want you to labor in vain. So I began to cry and say, Lord, show me what is it? What is it that you're doing that I may fit in? And he asked me another question. Do you know what I'm doing in your nation? I said, no. He said, do you know what I'm doing in the nations of the world? I said, no. Then said, if you don't know what I'm doing in the nations, how can you participate in the Great Commission? Because the Great Commission is go into the whole world and make nations disciples of God. So if you don't understand my purposes, my plans, and my work in the nations, how can you participate in the work of discipling nations? At that moment, I tried to remember one sermon I had ever heard about nations, and I could not remember even one. I could not remember any preacher, any teacher who had ever taught in my hearing concerning nations and God dealing with nations. And I cried to the Lord and said, please teach me. I do not know anything about nations. And he said, continue fasting. Amen. He says, continue fasting and go back and read my word like you have never read it before. Approach it from page to page and read it like you have never read the Bible before. I'm going to open your eyes. I did that. In the next 2 weeks, I just spent hours and hours just reading the word. And I was so excited. I was amazed. From Genesis to Revelation, I saw nations that I'd never seen before. I saw that everything God does since history He has only done it through nations. The only time God walked with man without applying nations is before the floods of Noah. We don't hear him talk about nations from Genesis 1 to Genesis 9. But in Genesis 10, that's the first time the word nations appears in the Bible. And he takes the three sons of Noah, and each of them he gives us a lineage. These are the sons of Ham, in their language, in their territories, in their nations. These are the sons of Japheth. These are the sons of Shem. And each of them was telling us in their languages, in their territories, in their families, in their nations. And in verse 32, Genesis chapter 10, he says, out of these three, all nations were spread out across the entire world after the floods. Suddenly I saw there is a mark in history where God says, at this point, I began to work on producing nations. And then I remember the scripture in the book of Deuteronomy 32, verse 8. It says, when the Most High divided up mankind into their nations, he gave them their boundaries and inheritance according to the number of sons of Israel. So it is God, it is spoken clearly in the Bible, it is God who is the maker of nations. It is God who founded the nations in their languages, in their territories, and in their ethnic identities. And in chapter 17 of Acts, it says, out of one man, he made all the nations of the earth to inhabit the earth. And he determined the exact places where people shall live and the times appointed for them. He did this that people will seek after him and grope after him and find him, although he's not far from us. So the first point I would like us to carry away tonight is God is in control. And God is the author of nations. If you know you are part of a nation, you are part of a language group, you are part of a people group, you are part of a tribe, you are part of a territory that is an autonomous territory, that is not just the working of man, it is the hand of the Lord. And he is the one who determines. When you go back in the scriptures, when he was taking the children of Israel to the land he had promised them, he would say to Moses, don't touch that land. I have given it to the Edomites. And if you go for it, I will not give it to you. Don't touch that one. I've given it to these people. Then in the next, he says, okay, you can go for that. So God apportions land. It's not a mistake when you look at a land like Singapore and say, wait a moment, who are we, the people of Singapore? And suddenly you realize we are different ethnic groups sharing the same territory. And you may think it's by mistake, it's by migration. Whatever you want to think, it's the God who moves people. It's God who scattered the people at the Tower of Babel. And he scattered them away and positioned them across the entire earth because they had determined they are not going to scatter. They're going to stay together. And yet he had given them a command. Go and fill the whole earth. When they refused to do it, he forced them to do it. And he scattered them and he apportioned them territories all across the world. And all of this he did because he had a plan for the nations. And what is interesting is, after he had apportioned them the lands, Genesis chapter 11, he had spread them out and they're in different languages and they did not understand each other. Then he went and found a man called Abraham, and said, come out of your father's house. Come out of your country and come out of your people. I will make you into a nation. And out of that nation, all the nations of the world shall be blessed. So at that moment, God had a plan for every nation on earth, for every people group on earth, for every language group on earth, for every tribe. But to be able to bring his plan and blessing to all the nations of the world, he needed a nation. He needed a nation to work things at the level of nations. Not just individual And when we go deep and look, there are things God can do to an individual and through an individual. There are other things he can only do on a corporate level, on a corporate basis. And they will drive people to respond corporately. And they will cause people to open up spiritually together. So God says, I am raising up Israel. But even as he was raising up Israel, his heart was on the nations. His heart was on the nations. All through the Old Testament, we see God treat the nations as though they were not a people. He loves Israel. He's faithful to Israel. He fights for Israel. He blesses Israel. He defends Israel. But all of that is doing because of his heart for the nations. And he works through the ages, thousands of years. And he sends prophets and says, I'm going to send a redeemer. I'm going to send a Messiah who will restore all things to my original plan. And one day, Jesus Christ comes on the scene. And Jesus ministers to only one nation. He does not go out of that nation. Even the first time he sends out his disciples, he said, do not go to any other people, but only the lost sheep of Israel. And he speaks to them. One day he met a Samaritan woman on the well, at the well, and asked her for water. And she began to talk nations to him. He says, oh, you Jews say that we should worship in Jerusalem, but our fathers say we should worship in Samaria. She was talking nations. And Jesus talked nations to her. He said, you worship what you do not know, but we worship what we know, because salvation is of the Jews. That is the Messiah. That's the Redeemer. That's the master of all creation. And he's speaking on national, on nation basis. And he says to the Samaritan, look here, your basis of religion, of worship is groundless. You don't even know what you're talking about. But we know what we're talking about. Why? Salvation belongs to the Jew. She didn't understand him. But this Jesus, after teaching for 3 years, went to the cross. He died. He rose again. And when he appeared to his disciples in Matthew chapter 24, the Bible says they did not believe. They were scared. He rebuked them for their unbelief. And then the Bible says, then he said to them, this is what I was talking to you about all the time I was with you. And the Bible says, then he opened their eyes to understand. And he said, from Moses to the prophets, to the Psalms, everything that was written about me had to be fulfilled. Now, just wait a moment. You may hear Moses, prophets, and Psalms. Do you know what that means? Moses wrote 5 books. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. So Jesus is saying, from Genesis, through all those books, everything that is being talked, narrated, was talking about me. And then the prophets, all the prophets, some people call them minor and major. He said, all of them, whatever they wrote, it was about me. Then to the Psalms, basically saying the entire Old Testament was pointing to one thing, the coming of the Messiah. And he says, whatever was written about me had to come to pass, that the Messiah had to come and he had to die and rise up again after 3 days. Then he said a profound statement. And then repentance of sins and forgiveness of sins would be preached to all nations in his name, beginning in Jerusalem. And you are my witnesses. So Jesus is saying, everything you read about God, dealing with Israel, dealing with Egypt, dealing with Babylon, dealing with all those countries, all those empires, everything you read through the prophets, it was all leading to one moment, and that moment is that the Messiah would come in the world, would pay the price, not only for personal salvation, but for the reconciliation of nations back to God. And says this was the purpose, that repentance and forgiveness of sins would be preached to the nations in my name, beginning in Jerusalem. And when he said the Holy Spirit would come, he said, you will receive power when the Spirit of the Lord comes upon you. Then you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and unto the ends of the earth. Beloved, when I was in this time of waiting upon the Lord, and he began to show me nations, I was so fascinated. I began to wonder, why is it that I've not had anybody teach about this? Why is it that this so profound element of God's truth is not talked about in many Christian circles? And then God opened my eyes to something that I had never thought. He said, when he sent the church to go take the gospel, he said, go into the whole world and make disciples of the nations. And he said, do you know that in the early church, they ministered to people according to the nations they were? Paul would say, when I go to the Jews, I know what the Jews think and what will get to them. They want to see the power of God. So I minister to them that way. When I go to the Greeks, they are different. They want wisdom. They want reasoning. So I come to them according to the way they are. When I go to people with the law of the Lord, I speak to them from that background. When I go to those who do not have the law, I speak to them from their point of view. I am everything to all people that I may win them to Christ Jesus. And the Lord asked me, how do you preach the gospel today? Simple word I can use, one size fits all. Yeah, we just do one size fits all. We don't even know, who am I talking to? And how do they hear me? When I say one thing, do they understand the same thing I'm saying, or they interpret it differently? Because they're coming from a different mindset. And the Lord began to show me, nations have got corporate mindsets. You find people of the same ethnic group think in a certain way, see things in a certain way. They abhor certain things. They desire certain things. They respect certain things. They despise other things. And if you just come and ignore all of that, you come back to the scripture in the second book of Corinthians, chapter 4, verse 3, where he says, if our gospel be hidden, it is hidden to those who are perishing, whose inner eyes have been blinded by the God of this age, that they may not see the glorious gospel of our Lord Jesus. So sometimes we blame the people. They don't want to believe. They are obstinate. They are rebellious. But God says, hey, wait a moment. If you think they don't see what you're bringing, if you think they are not hearing you, it's because they are blinded. It's because they are captives. It's because something is hindering them from seeing the glorious gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. And the Bible says Jesus was able to come and reconcile the world unto himself without counting their sins against them. He did not blame them, for God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world may be saved through him. If we are preaching the gospel today and we are wondering why our nations are going down the drain, they are not turning back to God. We are discipling many individuals, but we're not discipling the nations. It's because the nations are blinded. If you go to Isaiah chapter 25, verse 7 to 9, it says, and the Lord has vowed, he will destroy the veil that covers the nations and the blanket that enfolds the people. That's the veil that covers the nations and the blindness the blanket that blinds the people. And say, he will destroy it on this mountain. And he will destroy and take away the reproach and the shame and the tears of his people. Which means when this blanket of darkness is over nations, when this evil is over the people, there is shame, there is reproach, there's blindness, there's agony in the hearts of the people. And that's what we see all around us today. The suffering is getting worse and worse all across the world. It's becoming indescribable. And the Lord says, I want to destroy that yoke of darkness, that veil of evil that is over the nations. I want to destroy that blind that is holding my people in darkness. I want to destroy that power which is causing my people to be hard-hearted. That is why the Lord says in the last days, proclaim this among the nations. Prepare for war. Because before the day of the Lord comes, God is going to shake everything that can be shaken. He's going to shake the ocean. He's going to shake the sea. He's going to shake until only that which cannot be shaken shall remain. And it's only the kingdom of God that cannot be shaken. Do you begin to see? There are people out there, he says, multitudes and multitudes are in the valley of decision before the day of the Lord comes. And the Lord is saying to his people, come on now, rise up. Let even the weakling say, I am strong. Take up your positions in my ranks. We have got to go and break this yoke over the nations. We've got to go set the captives free. We've got to go open the gates of the prisons. We've got to go into every people group and break the bondage that is upon the people. And the Bible says in Isaiah chapter 25 verse 9, it says, and the people will say, this is our God. We waited for him and he has come. He has saved us. This is our God. Let us rejoice in his salvation. Oh, hallelujah. That day will come when everybody who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Because the blinds will be taken away. The bondage will be broken. The hard-heartedness will be swept away. And multitudes will come into the kingdom. A harvest such as has never been will be gathered into the kingdom of God. This is what the Lord is calling upon his church to see, to visualize, and to realize, hey, come on, we are being called to the most glorious time of the church in the history of the kingdom of God. And it's calling us to rise up, and it's calling us to seek his face, and it's calling us to take up our positions, everyone according to his purposes, to his calling, to his anointing, to his destiny in our lives. It's not one size fits all. It's not that we all do it the same way. It's not that we all do the same thing. Every one of us has got a calling. Every one of us has got a line that God has designed for him. It's about time there will be a people who know their God, a people who know who they are, a people who know why they are on earth at such a time as this. You remember Esther, the queen? When she looked at herself just as everybody, Mordecai said to her, you need to go and talk to the king. She said, I cannot. Nobody can. Anybody who goes in without permission. And Mordecai said, wait a moment. You are not anybody. How do you know that you have not come into the kingdom for such a time as this? You are not just an accident where you are. You are not just occupying a seat. You are there because God has put you there. And I want to say to every man and woman in this place, you are where you are because God has put you there. And when you look around and see the evil around you, you see the darkness around you, you see the blindness around you, you see the rebellion around you, God says, I am confident I have you there. You are an ambassador. And God is saying, it's okay, I have got someone there. There are certain places, certain people groups where the believers have not penetrated yet. And God is opening up those areas. Now, the mistake most of us do is that when we go into a territory and we have penetrated it and we have a church, we turn inward looking. We think we are there to serve ourselves, to bless ourselves, to fight for ourselves, and to just enjoy God. And God is saying, no, look around you. Look at the darkness around you. Look at the bondage around you. Look at the imprisonment around you. I put you in that I may have a detach. I may have a camp in there that will rise up and become the light in the darkness. That will rise up and become the salt of the earth. that will begin to break the yokes of darkness. And brothers and sisters, this is what it's all about. It's not about, oh, I belong to this group or that group, and I serve on Thursday, I serve on Sunday. It's about, who are you? Who are you? And do you know why you are in the kingdom at such a time as this? This is the call that even the weakling will say, I am strong. Beloved, I know I'm painting a very abstract picture. Very, very big. And maybe some of you think, where do I begin to identify in that? But I was before the Lord. And he was showing me this scenario in the Bible, how the early church preached the gospel with a mind for nations. And I was thinking, how does that now relate with us? How can I change? Then the Lord began to speak prophetically concerning my nation. Now, we can go and start defining what are nations before God according to scriptures, what are people groups, what are tribes, what are languages, what are kingdoms. But take it, let's just go with one concept, people groups for the time being. And the Lord was telling me, I have a plan for Uganda. I have a plan that I want to use this nation for. Just as I raised up Israel for a purpose, I raised up Uganda for a purpose. But that plan, if it comes to pass, Uganda will rise up and become a blessing among other nations. And I will use you to open ancient gates for other nations, and they will rise up into their own destiny. But because of that, the enemy knows it. And the enemy is fighting that you do not rise up into your destiny. And he will do anything, whether politically, socially, economically, spiritually, religiously. He will do anything just to keep you away from my destiny. And he says, this is true of every nation on earth, every people group on earth. And he began to speak prophecies of what he wants to do through our nation. And showing in the history, if you want to prove it, look back in the history, when I did this, when I did this, when I did this. And each time your people cried out, this is what happened. Then they went back to slumber. This is what happened. It says, this time I call upon you, call my people to the altar, to seek me not because of their crisis and not because of their problems and not because of their desires, to seek me for my purposes, to seek me that I will reveal to them my plans and purposes for your people. And when you begin to do that, I will teach you how to war against the forces of darkness. He says, look, whatever you see in government is not beyond your authority to touch. You can touch it and you can steer it. Whatever you see in the economy, it's not beyond your power. You can touch it, you can steer it. Whatever you see in the society, it's not beyond your power. You can touch it, you can steer it. That is what it means to rule with Christ in this generation. And in the generation to come, the people who know their God shall be strong, and they shall work exploits. Beloved, I want to say to you, it's not in vain that such a cry would come to Singapore at such a time as this. God moves in his timing. When it is his timing, he opens the door and nobody will close it. When we miss the timing, he closes the door and nobody will open it. I know that there are people in Singapore who have been hearing in their spirits the stirrings of the Holy Spirit, the cry of the Lord. They hear that urge, rise up, rise up. It's time to take the land, to possess the land for the Lord. There are people who have been hearing it. Some of you have even been hearing God tell you, lay down what you have been doing, for I have something else for you to do. And I want you to prepare yourself. I want you to give me time, give me space so that I can prepare you. It's a Kairos moment, and it's a moment for those who have got ears to hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying. So what is it that we have to do? God willing, that's what we want to try and dig into and come to a place where you say, personally, as an individual, I can see the next steps. As a church, we can see the next step. As a ministry, we can see the next step. Even as a business, we can see the next step. Even as a nation, we can begin to see the way forward.
Because this is what the Lord is doing. There is a trumpet sound going out in the nations and calling upon the people, awaken, prepare for war. Prepare for war. I want to pray that your spirit will hear what the Spirit of God is saying today. I want to pray that there will be something inside of you that will come alive and that will begin to yearn and to seek after the reality of God, something deeper than you have touched before. That yearning that was in the heart of David when he was in prayer before the Lord, and yet he said, as the deer panteth for the water, my soul longs for you. Oh my God, when will I come and appear in your presence? Because there was a deep thirst for the Lord. I pray that the Lord will give you a thirst even tonight, that as we raise our voices to him, that he will begin to stir our hearts, begin to stir us and not leave us to slumber. Just as God says, I will not hold my peace. For Zion's sake, I'll not hold my peace. And for Jerusalem's sake, I will not keep quiet until her brightness shines forth and her glory comes. Let us pray to God that we will not hold our peace. We will not rest. We will not go back to slumber or to a position of complacency, but we will begin to feel that agitating, and we want to seek after the Lord. That we will begin to seek to go deeper than we've ever gone before. This is not to discredit what we have gone through before. No, we are not discrediting that. But like Paul, we are saying, I forget what is behind me, and I reach forward to that which is to come. Amen? Because the things before us are greater than the things behind us. Amen? So I want to say to you, this is the first night we are together, and we've tried to paint this big picture that it's not just about, oh, let us pray for Singapore to be even more prosperous, or let us pray for Uganda because we've had war and because we've had AIDS, or let us pray for Sudan because, no, it's bigger than that. It's more eternal. It's more long-lasting, and it's more about the plans of God for humanity. There are plans and purposes in every nation that God wants to tap if we will call upon his name. Amen. May the good Lord bless you. I want to invite you to rise up onto your feet. And we take a short time of prayer. Maybe the worship team will come and let me ask. I know when we share things that are that abstract, sometimes we don't even know how to start praying. Sometimes we don't even know how to begin to call upon the name of the Lord. So I'm going to give you 2-3 suggestions. One, the Bible says, come into the courts of the Lord. Come into his presence with thanksgiving. Come with this joyful noise and know that he is the Lord. So I'm going to suggest that the first item of prayer we're going to do is not just to go and say, oh, Lord, have mercy upon us, but to come and say, you are God. You are glorious. You are powerful. You are beyond comprehension. And we come to give you praise. We come to thank you that you have a plan for us. And you are not just watching helplessly as the nations go crazy. You have a plan to bring up your kingdom and to glorify your name. So we will first bring our thanksgiving. Then second, let us present ourselves and say, Lord, here I am. I belong to you. You redeemed me. My life is not my own. My life belongs to you. I don't want to live my life aimlessly. I don't want to live my life just doing the routine. I want to plug into your purposes, plug into that reason that I'm alive today. So you offer yourself a living sacrifice. And we are going to pray. I'm going to suggest that we pray 2 by 2. So as you pray this prayer for someone else, you are sowing a seed and you are going to reap back. So that as they pray for you, they are sowing a seed in you. And lastly, I'll pray that we pray for Singapore. That God will move upon Singapore and the entire body of Christ in Singapore and raise Singapore into the ranks of his purposes. And that Singapore will find its place among the nations of Asia Pacific. That when God moves in the region, Singapore will be ready to play its role. Amen? Amen. So if you will, please, just join hands with one person. Just one person. And we are going to pray. You pray for that person prays for you.
Amen. And let us begin by just bringing thanksgiving to the Lord. Let's raise our voices in thanksgiving to the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank him. Come with thanksgiving. Come with praises to his name. Tell him you are an awesome God. You are glorious in all your ways. There's no comprehension to your plans and purposes. You are our maker. You are our creator. You have not lost control of this world. Everything is still under your control. You are the one that will rise up and bring it all to an end. When that day comes, you shall rise up, and every knee shall bow, and every tongue shall confess that you are the Lord. We lift up your holy name. We glorify you. We magnify you, O God, and proclaim that you are our God. We are your people, the sheep of your green pastures. We are privileged to be called your co-workers. We thank you that you have positioned us where we are to be able to represent the kingdom and to be ambassadors for your cause in this generation. We proclaim that your will shall come to pass. Your kingdom shall come and your will shall be done on earth as it is in heaven. Go ahead and begin to bring your body, your life, yourself as a living sacrifice to the Lord. Blessed be your holy name. Father, we come before you. The Bible says, offer yourselves a living sacrifice to God. Lord, we want to offer ourselves a living sacrifice to you. We want to give ourselves unto you, Lord Almighty. We want to give you our hearts, our minds, our thoughts, our time, our occupation, everything that we are to do with. We want to give it to you, Lord, and we say, let your will be done. Have your way, God. Have your way. Change our routines, change our focus, change our priorities, and refocus us on the things that you created us for, the things for which we are alive for such a time as this. Mighty One of Israel, in the fullness of time, you will come and reveal yourself to us. Lord, we pray that you prepare us, O God. Prepare us, O God, that when the time of our visitation will come, we'll not be unready. That we will be ready for the move of the Spirit. Arise, O God. Arise and let the enemies disperse. Arise, O Lord, and let the fire of the Holy Spirit move upon our hearts, King of Glory. Move, O God, move. Move in our hearts, O Lord. Move in our families, O God. Move in our businesses, move in our jobs, move in our congregations, O God. Move in our communities, O Lord. Move in the city, O God. Continue praying, continue praying. Lift up the body of Christ in Singapore. Lift up the pastors and the church leaders. Lift up the people of God and cry out to the Lord for a visitation. Say, Lord, rend the heavens and come down, O Lord. Let there be a visitation of your Spirit upon Singapore. Pour out, Lord, pour out of your Spirit, O God. Pour out upon our flesh in Singapore. Oh Lord, we pray that revival shall come to Singapore, that you shall shake the foundations, oh Lord. Lord, we pray that you shall take away the blinds. We pray that you shall awaken the spirits of your people. Oh, Rabasaka Yandere Boria Rabala Rabasanto Kobo. Oh God, arise. Arise in the name of Jesus. Singapore will belong to you. Singapore will honor your name. And every knee shall bow. And every tongue shall confess that you are the Lord and you are God. We give you praise. We give you glory. We give you honor.